Welcome back from that short break. We still have Herbert with us here, and he's explaining to us what measures as a board they put together to see that we limit and minimize these problems that we've been facing in this industry of construction. That laboratory, is it going to have the materials that are supposed, the genuine components, the genuine materials that are supposed to be used during the STC method of construction?
Hilda, as I've explained in the first segment, until we develop the guidelines about STCs, for now, our position remains that the method was prohibited by the minister. Give the sector, give the regulators time to develop the guidelines. Already the process is ongoing. Some of the proponents of this method have asked to be brought on board, to be part of the further studies of this method, and give us the time. We streamline this sector for the safety of you, me, and the Ugandans watching us, and those across the country.
You mentioned earlier that some countries that are using, the ones in Europe, those that are using this method, may be having professionals that we don't have here. Who is to blame?
We have the professionals here, but they had not taken keen interest in studying this method. Because it's new here, you get my point. So they also need time to adjust, to study, to learn this method. Let me give you an example. If you're constructing using this method, who will supervise you?
The national,
the building control officers do not know about this method. Some are just learning about it. And if they are supervising, what is their base of supervision? What are they basing on to supervise? Those should be the guidelines. And right now they are not there. So let's develop the guidelines.
Does that mean that at one point we may need even to import the expertise?
No. We have here. We shall study. If need be, we shall benchmark and develop the guidelines that are tailor-made for our sector. We're not saying that this method will not, at a certain time, be allowed. No. We are saying, let's study it. Let's develop the guidelines. Maybe at one stage, the guidelines will inform us on the next course of action. If we find out that now, the point we are at, we can advise the minister to lift the ban, that will be done. But until that is done, the method is not safe, as of now. And the proponents of this method know it, the professionals know it. Yes.
So if we're not going to use the STC method of construction, is there any other method you would recommend that may fit in may fit the purpose or the reason as to why most people have been rushing to use it in terms of cost cutting?
Hilda, let's get the principles right. The principles are, one, safety. The second one is safety. The third one is safety. Safety first. The new method has been found to be with some barriers. It is unsafe and it is risky. The alternative is there. The conventional method of construction, the method we all know, is still available. Let's not argue about costs. We should argue about safety. That is our responsibility.
Talking of safety, as a review board, we are told that some of the building materials that are on markets are not up to the standard. Now, before we even rush into the STC, as a review board, what measures have you put there to ensure that at least Ugandans get genuine building materials?
You're right. We are facing the challenge of the building materials. Some are made locally here, others are imported. And we've been working with the UNBS to monitor the standards of the building materials. But this work is enormous. And that's why I told you, after realizing that it's one of the biggest challenges we are having, that's why we are constructing the Building Materials Quality Assurance Center in Lobowa to ensure that we test our materials before they go on market. That is one way of ensuring that we monitor the building materials. It is a challenge we should admit, but as I've said before, if you're a manufacturer, or if why do you manufacture substandard materials? Because at the end of the day, you will also use the same building. It might be a shopping mall, which you supplied with a fake cement or any other building material. You will be there for a weekend enjoying a cup of tea and it collapses. Or one of your relatives or your family. You might be a supplier or an importer. Instead of importing standard building materials, you go for substandard. UNBS or URA or us, we might fail to detect you, but the end results will affect you. Just imagine people who supply fake construction materials for the roads. If the roads develop potholes, who is affected? All of us. So the way out is ensuring that we keep the sector as clean as possible from substandard materials.
Do you think that in one way or the other, some of the organs of the nation, like the boards, have failed us?
No, they have not. They are doing what they are supposed to do. That's why we advised, one of the actions we took was advising the minister prohibiting STC. We are doing what we are supposed to do. The professional bodies, I'll tell you for a fact, like for the engineers, they're also doing house cleaning. If they find out that you're not doing what you're supposed to do as a profession, they have been whipping them. Some have had their practicing licenses taken away from them. That is one way of ensuring that we clean up the sector. The same applies for other professional bodies. They are trying their best. But as you should also know, is that the sector is developing on a very fast rate. And the growth at which the sector is moving does not correspond with the rate at which our institutions of learning are releasing or channeling out the professionals. So the sector is growing at a very fast rate vis-a-vis the number of professionals that are coming out in the sector. But that should also not stop us from doing what is right. Can I tell you, those who go against the law, in most cases, are the ones that know about the laws or are in a position of following the law. For example, in terms of hiring the professionals, having standard materials, but instead, knowingly sometimes, they go against the law.
And then what happens?
So it's maybe a cultural problem that we are having. Maybe a behavioral problem that must be solved.
You see, like there are punishments for every lawbreaker. Mm. But in this case, what has been done for some people that have been breaking like continuously, breaking the laws that actually they know very much about.
One of the things we've done last year, we signed a memorandum of understanding with the office of the DPP, and that office created a division, the Building Control Crimes Division, to ensure that the cases to do with the sector are fast tracked. They are tried, and decisions are made swiftly. That we've done. Another thing is that now the DPP gave us officers who are attached to NBRB to ensure that they investigate and process the files in case of any offenders of the law. So we are doing our best to ensure that the law is implemented. But also another thing, we also realized that the law is not stringent enough. The Building Control Act does not give those stringent punishments that would deter people from committing the building offenses. But what we are doing is that we have started the process of amending the Act to ensure that it is tight enough to deter those who would attempt to break the law. So we are not seated, we are working.
Sometimes we have seen both. Each time there is a ban or an enactment of anything new, they tend to be so on it, very diligent, following it up. But 1 year down the road, it phases out. My question here is, how have you prepared yourself as a board to see that you stay on track?
One, we are persistent, we are following the law, and we have a capable team to monitor, supervise, and regulate the sector. We are on course, and we can't do this work in isolation. We have partnerships with professional bodies, we're engaging other government agencies to ensure that this is a concerted effort where we clean up the sector. We don't want to work in isolation. We are working with other sector players to ensure that this sector is clean. So, watch us. We are consistent and we are here to ensure that this sector is clean. Yes.
You mentioned about some of the sectors that you are using. Okay, you're working with to ensure that our building industry, our construction industry is high notch. Could you drop us a few of those ones that you are in partnership with, please?
I told you we're working with the office of the DPP. Mm-hmm. We're working with the professional bodies, for architects, for engineers, for the surveyors. Mm-hmm. We're working with the National Physical Planning Board, mm-hmm. and the Physical Planning Committees. Mm-hmm. Last week we had a meeting where we are trying to harmonize or clearly define the roles of the building committees and the physical planning committees. We are working with them. And we're also trying to go digital.
Okay.
We developed an online platform known as the Building Industry Management System, BIMS, where we are trying to digitize all the building control services. In that, we want to see a sector that is paperless, where if you're a developer and you want to apply for a building permit, a building occupation permit, you don't need to walk to, say, Machindye. You can sit on your laptop in your office, you apply for a building permit, you schedule for routine inspection, you pay the building fees, you get instant feedback on the services you request for, and raise any other issues online. This is one of the ways where we are coming up with to also reduce on the masqueraders in the sector. There are those who masquerade as professionals, but on the system, all registered professionals, engineers, architects, surveyors, will be on the system. If you bring your designs and you purport that these designs were cleared by Herbert Ziwa, were stamped by Herbert Ziwa, I should be on the system. If I'm not the system, your designs will be rejected. There and then, because I'm not qualifying. So this is one of weeding out masqueraders, because they are one of the causes of the accidents we are facing. So this system is up and running. We've piloted it. It is now operational in Jinja, Kira, Kampala is on board, Entebbe, and we are moving. We want to ensure that whoever is now applying for a building or an occupation permit, they are doing it online. And this system is going to be launched on 2nd December this year. So we are working and we're ensuring that this sector is streamlined.
Great. Now I'm also looking at this scenario. Hilda comes, has a building. I go ahead, contact developers, the architects. They do the drawings and they advise me on what to use. Because I know them as professionals, I'll go with maybe what they've advised me to go with. If things go wrong, for instance, in this case where we are talking about the STC, now who is punished?
I beg you, stop talking about STC, because I've explained to you the method was prohibited. So there's nothing more we can say about it until the guidelines are developed. But the other question, that's why I told you that whoever you as a developer, you hire as a profession, they should be registered with their professional bodies, which holds them accountable for their actions and inactions. You don't just come from nowhere and hire someone. You should be able to track them. You should be able to know where they come from. And if someone purports to be a professional, they will be detected at the point of permit issuance. Because no building permit can be given out if it is not stamped, if the drawings are not stamped or cleared by the professional. Who is registered? So these are the checks we have in the sector. Unless you go and construct without approvals. But as long as you have your approvals, they must be cleared. And the only way they can be cleared by the building committee or the professional or the professionals on your papers must be certified, must be recognized by their professional bodies.
Let's talk about the sensitization.
Yes.
Have you done a lot of sensitization for people to know that this method is abolished, or what is the right method to be used apparently, as the other one is still undergoing?
Hilda, we are doing general sensitization. First of all, of what we are doing as NBRB, our mandate. We're also doing sensitization on what should be done by the sector players to ensure that we are safe. For the STC, we had a press conference here. We've engaged. That's why you're here. We've clarified. We've maintained our position. And we've set the record straight. So we are doing sensitization. That's why I'm here, to ensure that the sector is clean. And we call upon Ugandans, please, be you're the eyes of this institution. Report. Recently we launched the Wait As A campaign.
What is the Wait As A campaign?
We are running it on our social media platforms before we go out in the mainstream media. But we are also having talk shows and other engagements about this Wait As A campaign. In this Wait As A campaign, we are calling for compliance. We are calling on Ugandans to report any building safety concerns they have in their areas. They can report to the building committees in those areas. They can also report directly to us. We are telling them that if you find a building that is on the verge of collapsing, that has cracks, that is having electric wires exposed, that is having water passing through it, please report. Come to us. Contact us on our toll-free numbers.
You have heard it from the horse's mouth, and the choice is yours. What you consider here is safety vis-a-vis the cost cutting. This is the Homes and Construction Affairs Show, and my name is Hilda Kamkama. Until next time, bye-bye.